he has some exotic things about magnetic monopole and Shah's work. So let us start. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Manjari. So first of all, I begin by thanking Dr. Manjari, Professor Mani, Professor Murthy for, and other organizers of this conference for inviting me. And this is a superb place to talk about fundamental stuff. So if we can have the lights off so that we can, right. So of course, late Professor Meghnad Saha, his most enduring work is in the field of astrophysics. But it's also a fact that he did quite insightful work even in quantum theory. Here you can see Professor Saha with the D's of the cyclotron. Now, we are going to talk about Professor Saha in the world of quantum mechanics, but the world of quantum mechanics is itself quite bizarre. We know that the quantum mechanical system is always in a Hamiltonian state, whether the state is to behave like particle or wave is always a matter of great dilemma till you set up the right kind of experiments, as in the case of two-slit experiment. But more bizarre is the aspect of quantum mechanical system interacting with other quantum mechanical system, for example, an apparatus. Then always, if the state is not an eigenstate of the observed dynamical variable, then the result is an entanglement between the quantum system and the apparatus. However, when you read out the pointer state, there's no entanglement. You always see one of the pointers albeit with a probability. And where the probability comes from, that is the so-called Born rule, that is still a central paradox of quantum mechanics, because every interaction, whether it's an apparatus or quantum system, is a Hamiltonian interaction. So therefore, the evolution must always be unitary, and their probabilities have no reason to appear. So the, I'll skip this slide. So why probabilities should enter is still a matter of great debate. So in other words, the probabilities appear only when you are talking about reading the pointer state, which necessarily, because human beings are macroscopic systems, and therefore, in order they can observe, the signals have to be multiplied or amplified by via large macroscopic system. So somewhere, probably it's a large number of degrees of freedom might be playing in getting the probabilities, or there are no collapse, rather there is many world interpretation coming into action, but that's something still debatable. But what is more philosophically bizarre is, after all, we ourselves are made out of quantum systems, and when we are trying to fathom the rules of fundamental physics, it is the one set of quantum systems which have given rise to conscious observers, which are themselves made of quantum systems, are trying to find out what the laws of quantum systems are, the so-called a kind of a feedback, which is a philosophical mystery. And as I mentioned, the entanglement and the measurement problem can be superbly summarized by Schrodinger's cat paradox, which basically says that if you have a cat in an enclosed box with a radioactive nucleus like cobalt-60, and there is a GM counter out there whose clickings are amplified, and imagine that when there's a click, this talk is relayed, and when this cat hears the talk, because of sheer boredom, it dies. So when there's a click, it hears the boring lecture and dies. If there is no radioactive decay, then it survives. So in principle, the combined state of the whole system gets an entangled state. If there's a decay, there's a click, the talk is relayed, and the cat is dead. Plus, there's no decay, no click, no talk, cat is alive. So in principle, from quantum unitary evolution, you have this entangled state. But whenever you open the box, you always see that there is a click, then cat dead, or no click, cat is still alive. And where the collapse is happening, that's the central problem of quantum measurement. Let me skip this. This is also related Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen paradox, where the collapse can be triggered at space-like distances, and so-called spooky action at a distance. Let me not go into this. Let me come back to Meghnad Saha's foray into quantum theory. What is surprising is one of his first paper was actually application of old quantum mechanics to astrophysics. And to my mind, whatever I have researched, probably Meghnad Saha was the first Indian physicist who applied quantum theory to astrophysical problems. So this is the paper which he wrote around 1919, where he uses the fact that the classical Poynting vector, which follows from Maxwell's equation, cannot give sufficient radiation pressure when you have atoms and molecules around. Rather, you have to take into account only those frequencies that get selectively absorbed because of the discrete states, and therefore there is selective radiation pressure. The historians of science might wonder as to what caused the series of causally connected work of Saha and Bose into the quantum world. Now, it turns out, again, I don't know whether Professor Abha Sur is around, so probably, she can throw some light on the historical causal connection. To my mind, I think what is very important is to highlight the role of Ashutosh Mukherjee, who was a distinguished mathematician, but then he took to judicial law studies, but he kept a keen interest in physical sciences. So he had set up University College of Science as a part of Calcutta University around 1916. And after a long struggle, Saha and Bose managed to find a teaching position in University College of Science, thanks to Ashutosh Mukherjee. And as Satyen Bose writes, one fine morning, Ashutosh wanted to meet the young teachers. And he said that, look, you guys are very enthusiastic about teaching new courses. So what do you plan? What new things you would like to teach? Then Bose meekly said that, you know, you can suggest us what we should be taking up. Then what Ashutosh apparently did was he assigned Saha to study quantum theory. Remember, this is 1916. Quantum theory is fairly young. And he suggested Bose should study relativity so that the young students can be taught the new advances that are happening in physics. And no wonder the first English translation of the original papers of Einstein and Minkowski, which were in German, they were brought out by Saha and Shottan Basu. I have deliberately written Shottan Basu because in all papers of Meghnad Saha, he refers to S.N. Bose as S.N. Basu, okay? The original surname as it is used in Bengali. And if you look at some of the works of Saha, it is clear that he was highly influenced by Einstein's work on relativity, although remember that he was actually assigned to study quantum theory by Ashutosh. And in particular, he always comes back to the role of inertial mass. Just to give an example, we all know the paper on special relativity by Einstein was given this particular title. Similarly, in 1918 itself, Saha writes a paper whose title is On the Dynamics of the Electron. You can see the just in the title itself, the similarity. Similarly, in the paper, The Origin of Mass in Neutrons and Protons, where actually he talks about magnetic monopoles in a very short manner. Here, Bose always used very simple but very insightful point. Here, what he does is he tries to use the Dirac quantization to estimate the mass of the magnetic monopole. We'll come to that later. But of course, we all know the most famous work of Meghnad Saha is the thermal ionization of atoms and molecules in the presence of intense radiation of stars. But as I said, he was influenced by Einstein's work. But here there's a surprise in the sense, again, it's for the historians of science. Einstein never worked in the field of astrophysics, except for a couple of lines he made a comment. Here are those couple of lines. Since I don't know German language, I don't know what exactly he was saying. He was commenting on the continuum radiation from the solar corona, how they'll be absorbed by the free electrons. But apparently, Anderson later on came back and showed that the absorption will not be appreciable. But apart from these five lines, Einstein never made any comment on astrophysics. Saha, of course, went about talking about solar corona, giving, using his ionization equation to show what kind of discrete lines from calcium and other elements which are present in the corona could be seen. Right, so the question is that, is it, again, it's just a puzzle, I'm just, trying to guess why Einstein avoided working on astrophysics. Is it because when he tried to apply general relativity to problem of cosmology and trying to get a static universe, he introduced cosmological constant, thereby failing to predict an expanding universe, and that's why he called introduction of cosmological constant as a blunder. Could it be because of that which sort of inhibited him to work on astrophysics and cosmology later? Which is rather an irony, because astrophysics is one subject where general relativity gets tested again and again, particularly in recent times where gravitational waves from compact binary objects were directly detected. Right, so let's come back to the first paper of Saha on selective radiation pressure, where he showed that people have already worked out the result that the classical radiation pressure, which follows from the Poynting flux, they cannot sort of ripple by virtue of transporting momentum to them when the objects that are involved, that are coming in front of the radiation, are of atomic dimension. Then he goes about. So that is the problem. But then with his insight, he shows, but after all, these atoms and molecules, they have discrete quantum energy levels. So therefore, in the continuum radiation that is coming out of sun or other stars, those frequencies which exactly correspond to the difference in the energy levels of the bound states present in whether hydrogen or calcium or any other molecules, at least when they are absorbed, the momentum will be transported, and these microscopic structure thereby would be rippled outwards because of the radiation pressure. And here he particularly mentions that that this analysis, it is like what Einstein used when he talked about photo ejection in the case of photoelectric effect. So this selective radiation pressure of Saha was one of his early original contribution to astrophysics. Then he goes up towards the end of the paper. He talks about how the selective radiation pressure can lead to tails of comets. That is, when the comets come close by, close to the sun, then the radiation pressure acting on the carbon monoxide and dry ice present in the comet, they will lead to a tail which is in the direction outward to the sun because of the solar radiation. And he also talks about using the same physical phenomena to talk about solar prominences and the corona of the sun. By the way, please feel free to stop me and ask me questions anytime. Later on, of course, he goes about applying one of Satyen Bose's work. Again, note that he has spelt his name as S.N. Basu, in which Satyen Bose did some work to show even when many electrons are present in an atom, you can do some kind of old Bohr-Sommerfeld kind of thing to estimate the binding energy. He uses the expression of Bose's work to talk about the ionization potential as a function of the radius of the atom. So he was all the time involved in using the old quantum theory to estimate things which can be measured in the laboratory. Again, the historians of science can point out whether I am right in this. In my research, I found that the only paper that Saha co-authored with S.N. Bose was this one, in which they calculated the effect of finite molecular size on the equation of state of the gas. It's again another insightful work where they say that if you take the effect on the equation of state where pressure is related to the temperature, there are two constants, A and V, related to interaction between gas molecules and the finite size. What Saha and Bose, they point out is that this A and B cannot be constant. They use the entropy. From entropy and the finite size, they show that there is a effect, a crucial effect on the equation of state. Then there is a piece of work where Saha actually went wrong. This is regarding spin of photon. And here, C.V. Raman and Bhagavantam were in the right track. What C.V. Raman and Bhagavantam sort of concluded by looking at polarization, the circular polarization of Raman scattered photons, they concluded from circular polarization and trying to analyze it in terms of conservation of angular momentum, they concluded that circular polarization must correspond to the spin of the photons, whereas in this note in the Nature, Saha argues that he gives examples of other experiments like the D-line and Zeeman effect to argue that in some cases it appears that the photons don't have spin, and therefore he disagrees with Raman and Bhagavantam's work, but clearly it's one instance where he was quite far apart from what was the reality. Right, now let's come to the central problem, namely the magnetic monopoles. Now, monopoles, of course, were discussed a long time back. People like J.J. Thomson and Poincaré, they sort of delved into the field, because if you have magnetic charges, then Maxwell's equation, the so-called extended Maxwell's equations, have greater symmetry. But of course, we know that if you divide a standard bar magnet, you can't separate into north and south pole. Every time you divide, you still end up with a dipole magnet. But imagine that if you have a fundamental magnetic charge, whether it's north pole or south pole, then you would have, if it's a north pole, then the magnetic fields will be going radially outwards, and vice versa in the case of a magnetic south pole. And one knows classically, and that's what J.J. Thomson had worked out elaborately, and interestingly, Saha had closely followed J.J. Thomson's work. And it was clear that if you have a magnetic monopole and a charged particle, then charged particle's trajectory follows, it moves on the surface of the cone. This axis remains fixed. We will come to see soon what this cone's axis represent. And this can be verified, we all know from Maxwell's equation, if you have inhomogeneous magnetic field and a charged particle comes, then as it enters stronger magnetic field zone, the gyro radius keeps becoming smaller. So this thing which we study in our MSc can be straight away applied to the magnetic monopole work. Now I have to do one thing I have just learned. Let's see. Yeah. So let's go into this work is, I mean, probably already done by J.J. Thomson. So imagine that you have an electric charge Q with mass small m, and it's moving about. So its position vector with respect to the origin is R2, and it's moving in the field of a magnetic monopole with charge G, magnetic charge G, and mass capital M. Then we can write down the system of equations. So magnetic monopole will satisfy this equation because of the Lorentz force on the magnetic monopole due to the electric field of the charge, while the charge particle, it will face a Lorentz force due to the magnetic field of the monopole, and you have these two sets of equation. Of course, we can reduce the two-body problem to a single-body problem by the usual technique of center of mass vector and the relative position vector, and it just becomes essentially a single body problem where the center of mass keeps moving uniformly, and why the relative position vector, it satisfies as though it's a particle of charge Q moving in the magnetic field produced by a magnetic monopole. Now let's look at the angular momentum of the combined system. So angular momentum of the monopole, angular momentum of the charge particle using this center of mass position vector and relative thing. This whole angle, total angular momentum is just angular momentum of the center of mass and angular momentum of the effective single body. Now this angular momentum will not change with time because if one takes the derivative, because of r double dot being 0, d LCM by dt is 0, so that rate of change of the total angular momentum is simply the rate of change of angular momentum of the effective reduced mass. And one finds that dl by dt is not 0. Rather, because of this fact, you can, one, some simple vector tricks can reduce to this expression, and one can show what is conserved is the total mechanical angular momentum of the combined system minus GQ by C and a unit vector which connects the charge particle with the magnetic monopole. So in other words, the mechanical angular momentum minus GQER by C is a constant vector. Thomson had shown, I have not seen his original paper, but it can be easily worked out that because the electric field due to charge at a given some position, charge particle is moving about, R2 is dependent on time. So if one takes a external point, the electric field due to the charge particle is given by this. By the way, this is a non-relativistic calculation. That means one is not considering the electric field produced by a moving magnetic monopole or the magnetic field produced by a moving electric charge, because in V by C is taken to be negligibly small. Similarly, the magnetic field at a given point due to monopole is this, then one can work out what is the angular momentum of the electromagnetic field, which will be the integral of the Poynting vector cross product wherever one is calculating and integrating over the space. And after doing some integration, one can easily show that the angular momentum of the electromagnetic field is given by this, where R of t is the reduced mass position. Of course, that's time dependent. So therefore, the direction is changing. Magnitude of the angular momentum is just GQ by C, but the direction of the angular momentum of the field is pointed towards the magnetic monopole, and it of course keeps changing where the particles, they are going in that conical orbit. Now what is very interesting to note, and I'm sure Saha was surprised by that, is that the angular momentum of the field in which you have a charged particle and a magnetic monopole, the value is a pure constant. It doesn't depend upon anything else. it only depends upon the direction that is the unit vector connecting the monopole and the charge. Everything else is a constant. And probably that is what Saha utilized. Saha said that this must be, after in quantum theory, angular momentum is quantized. So the first thing is, of course, therefore, that it is a total angular momentum which is conserved, because we had argued that this one is a constant vector, and just now we argued that this part is the angular momentum of the electromagnetic field. So in other words, one is seeing that the mechanical angular momentum of the charge monopole system plus the angular momentum of the electromagnetic field, that is what is conserved. And Saha argued that because angular momentum has to be conserved, he set a minimum angular momentum for spin up particle is barred by 2. And just now we are having a discussion with Professor Rajshekharan. He was also highlighting the fact that Saha did not set it to NH bar. He actually set it to NH bar by 2. Although electromagnetic field is a bosonic field configuration, he should have been led to writing it as NH bar. But he somehow, in his paper, he says that it should be half H bar. And he gets the Dirac quantization condition. Then he went about, so this is 1936, 5 years after Dirac. But what is very interesting is Dirac used the vector potential. And for him, it is the so-called line singularity of the vector potential, because if you have magnetic charges, then divergence of B is no longer 0. And therefore, you can't have non-singular vector potential everywhere. That was the condition. And of course, imposing single valuedness of the wave function of the charge. But in Saha's way of working, there's no vector potential. It's purely electric field and magnetic field and a semi-classical quantization of the angular momentum associated with the electromagnetic field. But what is interesting is that Saha goes about using this to estimate the mass of the monopole, assuming that monopole has a size Rm, just like how Abraham deduced the mass size relation for the electron. And so he just sets the potential electromagnetic potential energy is this, rest energy is this, and therefore uses that. And then if Saha chooses Rm to be the same as the classical electron size, but today we could take Rm to be some nuclear size, one Fermi, and one finds that this kind of Saha-like analysis gives the mass to be 2000 MeV. Of course, it's more than a factor of 2 of what really is the mass. Then in the paper, he says that Daulat Singh Kothari, in an interaction with him, incidentally, D.S. Kothari, who was the founder of the Department of Physics and Astrophysics at Delhi University, was also Saha's research student, and he mentions that, he mentions that D.S. Kothari thinks that possibly neutron is a composite of a magnetic north pole with magnetic south pole. I think Saha talks about this because, well, the mass, if it turns out to be more than neutron mass, but if you have a bound state between a magnetic north pole and magnetic south pole, because of the attractive force, mass can be reduced, possibly. He doesn't explicitly mention it in his paper, and maybe that's the reason he talks about lowering the mass by having an attractive bound system between a magnetic north pole and magnetic south pole, which he mentions that it was suggested by D.S. Kothari. And then he tries to find the bound state energy levels using Dirac equation. So by 1936, Saha already had moved from old quantum theory to actually doing quantum mechanics using Schrodinger and Dirac's formalism. For the completeness sake, let me also say that Dirac, on the other hand, he used a different approach where which was of course physically motivated by the fact that you can think of a magnetic charge or a magnetic monopole as the end of an infinitely thin long solenoid. So you could think of that thin long solenoid as the Dirac string, so that one end will be like a magnetic north pole or a magnetic south pole. And then Dirac imposed that the wave function must not see this Dirac string, and he got the quantization condition. Here C and H bar has been taken to be unity in this slide. So there is another way of looking at that, and that is using the Aharonov-Bohm effect. We all know that the celebrated paper of Aharonov and Bohm in 1959, they argued that if you carry out the two-slit experiment with an electron where you keep near the central region a thin long solenoid, very thin, so that much, much thin compared to the wavelength of the electron, so that when the electron passes through both the slit, then it doesn't see the solenoid. And because in the regions where there are no magnetic field, presence of the vector potential alters the phase of the wave function. So the electron which goes through slit number 1, its wave function will be given by this, where psi 1 rp would be if there was no solenoid at all. And similarly, the electron which goes through slit number 2, its wave function will be given by this, while psi 2 is the same experiment without the solenoid. Then if you take this out, then you just see that the wave function, the superposed wave function, there is this factor. But this factor is directly physically realizable because close integral of A along this path is related to the magnetic flux. And therefore, although the electron is not seeing the solenoid, but because there is a trapped magnetic flux, that will lead to a phase shift. And that was something which was indeed discovered later on experiments with very thin whiskers of magnetic material acting as the solenoid. So in other words, this magnetic flux through this solenoid is observable, and you can use it to explain the Dirac quantization. Imagine that you have a magnetic monopole very far away in the universe, so that is the Dirac string is the so-called string which has the same magnetic flux trap going out this way. But Dirac string is something unphysical, so therefore there should not be really any fringe shift. That can happen only if this phase factor is integral multiple of 2 pi n. And that's how you again get back the Dirac quantization condition. So in other words, this way of looking at the quantization of the product of the charge, electric charge and the magnetic charge, relies on the vector potential, which was not the case in Saha's argument. And later on, H.A. Wilson also came out with the same kind of analysis in 1949, and Saha was quick to send a rejoinder. He said that he had done the same work way back in 1936. But note that Saha's work, he's very terse. He is reticent about the details. He just says that if you take electric charge E and magnetic pole, he calls the magnetic charge mu, then he just says that the line joining them, the electromagnetic field angular momentum is the product of the charge and magnetic charge divided by C along the line joining that. And then he says it's quantized half H bar. Possibly he just says that because everything else has been already done by J.J. Thomson, so he did not repeat the exercise. Right, so now, so I'll just, since there is a lot of time, I can also describe something I worked on several years on trying to make the so-called symmetry between electric charge and magnetic charge a gauge symmetry. So the idea is, of course, well known that in Dirac's kind of work, if you have magnetic charge as well, then you have extended Maxwell's equation, which is a standard Maxwell's equation, but now that you have magnetic charges, now the divergence of the dual of the electromagnetic field tensor is no longer zero, and the modified Lorentz force equation becomes this when there is a magnetic charge. And this set of equation is symmetric under the electric magnetic duality rotation, namely you can make this transformation, the field tensor transforms like this, the electric charge transforms in the following manner, while the magnetic charge transforms in this manner, and therefore one can easily check that the standard extended Maxwell's equation is invariant under this duality rotation. The question is whether one can gauge this symmetry, and that is what I attempted, and it can be done easily by complexifying the problem. So you define a complex field tensor in terms of the standard Maxwell field tensor plus I times the dual of the field tensor, and then one can show that the extended Maxwell's equation can be expressed as del mu g mu nu of the complex current density. The imaginary part is related to the magnetic charge current density, and similarly the Lorentz force can also be expressed by this. But then one can ask, if you want to make the duality rotation local, that means these angles are no longer constant but they become space-time dependent, then obviously you have to modify the approach. So the whole idea therefore was to say that introduce a complex scalar field such that under a gauge duality rotation the complex field transforms like a U1 field, and the charges are related to the scalar field by some coupling parameter alpha. So therefore the electric charge or the magnetic charge comes out because of a coupling between the point particles and the scalar field, and then one can define, because once you gauge you have to have a gauge covariant derivative, and one of the interesting thing is that you don't need for the point particle sector the gauge covariant derivative doesn't require a gauge field, it can be the same scalar field can be used. On the other hand, for the scalar fields gauge covariant derivative you need another U1 field, that for the scalar field sector, and the idea is that use the same Higgs mechanism. So write down a lambda phi 4 kind of a Lagrangian density for the scalar field that is generating the electric charge and magnetic charge, and then when there is a symmetry breaking then phi takes a value 0 rho, and therefore after symmetry breaking there are no magnetic charge, you have rotated it, there are no magnetic charge, there are only electric charge. So that is something which I had worked out several years back, but there was a bottleneck, and that's why I did not pursue it further. That is, this is only in the electromagnetic theory, but we all know that electromagnetic theory is part of the unified electroweak theory. How do you incorporate it in the standard Salam Weinberg model? So after that I did not pursue this, because this kind of a symmetry holds good only in the electromagnetic sector. It would be interesting if the entire analysis can be extended to the electroweak theory. So let's come to, as I remarked, that although in the earlier work Saha was using the old quantum theory, simple things like Bohr Sommerfeld quantum results, but by 1936, for example in the magnetic monopole problem, and where he discusses neutrons being composite states of magnetic monopole and anti-monopole, he already started using the Dirac equation. So he constantly kept in touch with the so-called development in quantum mechanics, which astrophysicists like us, it's a surprise, because we tend to think that Saha essentially worked on astrophysics, but then his work on nuclear physics, he uses a lot of this Born approximation to study the nuclear reactions. But interestingly, looks like Saha was a very practical man. He never entered the philosophical aspects of quantum mechanics. Things like the deeper aspects of quantum mechanics, where for the first time, imaginary numbers become part of the real world, no longer just mathematical tools. Saha is very silent about that. Probably that was his personality, that he wanted to use whatever fundamental work was happening to directly relate them with experiments. Anything that had no experimental consequences, he was very silent about it. What is very important is later on, his students, D.S. Kothari, and Orlok was an associate of D.S. Kothari, who had fantastic acumen in mathematical analysis, they were doing very original and fundamental work concerning quantum theory. For example, I am thankful to Dr. Bhavatosh Bansal of ICER Kolkata, who pointed out these two papers to me. And this is very interesting, that 1952, D.S. Kothari and Orlok, as soon as lamb shift thing was discovered, they were saying that, okay, there could be shift if you have collection of atoms in very dense radiation bath, even the black body radiation could also affect the shift. They could also cause screening of the nuclear electric charge, effective screening of nuclear electric charge. And similarly, Kothari, and as you can see, both the papers were communicated by Saha himself, and later on, Kothari, he also worked out about ionization, which is not due to thermal radiation, but when you have cold system, but dense, the density, the pressure could also quantize it. And there, Kothari, Majumdar, as one knows, Professor Mani, he was one of the first person to tell me the link that we should, the Delhi University people must take cognizance of Saha's birth centenary, because all these people, Professor Kothari, Professor Orlok, Professor Majumdar, they were the people who set up the physics and astrophysics department of Delhi University. But since I was never, sorry? This all in probably communicated probably in proceedings of Royal, yeah, because that's where probably Saha, because he was a FRS, that's how he communicated these papers. Which I was not aware of, because since I never had any association with Delhi University till I joined the department as a faculty. So thanks to Professor Mani, who pointed out that there were very, very strong links between the doyens of our department with Professor Saha. Okay. So as we can see that, by the way, I desisted from talking about the Saha equation, because I thought the Saha equation is a standard thing, everyone talks about it. I wanted to concentrate on his sort of presence in the world of quantum mechanics. But Saha, of course, he was a very versatile physicist, starting from the classical theory of electron, his work on Fabry-Perot interferometers, which today is playing a very big role in the direct detection of gravitational waves. I wonder if he had known about the limits to which today's interferometers are being put to, whether he himself would have talked about the quantum aspects of Fabry-Perot interferometers in the sense of squeezed light and quantum non-demolation experiments. So his foray into astrophysics is of course phenomenal. Then he works in statistical mechanics, cosmic rays, river plans, particularly Damodar Valley Project, as a builder of institutions, education, society, and also standing for election. So he sort of straddled many worlds. So probably Everett could have just guessed many world interpretation by looking at Saha's world. And you So we come back. I started with the cat paradox, but in many ever world interpretation, there is never a collapse. It's just that whenever you make a measurement, one aspect of yours get correlated to a branch where the cat is alive. So you see the cat is alive, that is evolving in an independent way. There's another copy of yours which sees the cat is dead, that is. So every time there is an interaction, many world interpretation would say there's no collapse, it's just that it's branching out into superposed but entangled states. It's a beautiful interpretation because you don't bring in a rule, everything is unitary evolution, but there is a problem with this picture also. It cannot reproduce the observed fact that a branch we see with probability following the bond rule. So where is the bond rule probability coming in from the many world interpretation is still a mystery. So in other words, we are still stuck up, how do probabilities enter quantum mechanics? Thank you very much. So any questions? Yeah. Yeah, that is, if I want to gauge the duality symmetry. So we know that, yeah. So standard electrodynamics with monopoles, this is a global U1 symmetry is present. That means if theta is constant, then this set of transformation, it leaves the extended Maxwell's equation invariant. So the basic idea was that after all, except for baryon number and lepton number, which are global symmetries, all other symmetries are actually gauged. So therefore, around 1992, this paper was presented by me in Aronov's 60th anniversary. So this has appeared in the Fishcrib volume. That time I was interested in knowing what happens if you gauge the electric and magnetic duality symmetry. And then of course you realize that when you try to gauge it, then the electric charge and magnetic charge, they cannot be constant. So you see that if theta becomes space-time dependent, then the new electric charge, new magnetic charge, they are no longer constant, they are space-time dependent. So that's a puzzle. So how do you talk about space-time dependent charges? So that's where I sort of proposed that there is a scalar field, complex scalar field, which under local electric magnetic duality rotation transforms like a local U1 field, and the charges are related. So there's a global scalar field. The electric charge or magnetic charge is because these particles are interacting with the scalar field. The inspiration is the Higgs field and how it generates mass. That's the real inspiration. Just like actually there are no masses in the electroweak theory, the masses appear because of the Yukawa coupling with the fermionic fields with the Higgs field. So that is the idea. That inspiration came from electroweak theory. But the fact remains that the observed electric charge, they are constants. So the constant happens because there is eventually, because of this lambda 5-4 theory, there's a spontaneous symmetry breaking. So if you choose phi to be some vacuum expectation value v and 0, that means the top part if it is non-zero, bottom, then magnetic charges become 0. All magnetic charges become 0, you're left with only electric charges. This work I had after Cabrera's, you know, the so-called claim about detection of magnetic. So in part, I wanted to say that even if you have magnetic charges, if you have gauged duality rotation, then by choosing a gauge, you can remove all the magnetic charges. So that was a real inspiration. Sorry?
What
the same. I mean, once the symmetry breaking has taken place, now you don't have magnetic charge anymore. If you try to, there is a n, so n is 0. So in the Dirac quantization condition, it is always 0. No. This is purely, as far as this analysis is concerned, it's purely classical. One is not using the quantum nature of the charge particle, no wave function of the charge. Yeah, Professor Raj Shikran. Yeah. There's now a real scalar field. Also, massive vector boson. Yes. So there's a real particle after the symmetry breaking, and there's a massive vector boson, gauge boson, yes. But then the reason I sort of,
this is one remark you made about the Raman and Bhagavantam's paper.
Yes.
On angular momentum of the photon. I want to have your views, because there, if you take the forward scattering of the Raman effect and do with a polarized photon, it's such a clean statement about angular momentum of a photon, similar to what Compton's paper was.
Right.
But I rarely see this coming at the level of our MSc physics. Or this was in fact pointed out to me by Professor Haridas. That's where I found out about this. And I have been campaigning and trying to tell people who are writing papers on angular momentum of the photon in particle physics. As you know, there are a lot of work on spin of the proton, which involves Compton scattering, deep inelastic Compton scattering, and so on.
Right.
But unfortunately, it has had very little effect.
I think this should be introduced in the curriculum. But there's a very, here, directly one is linking the classical circular polarization of electromagnetic waves with the spin part. There's a clear connection between experiments.
And forward scattering, one doesn't need any mathematics at all. It's absolutely straightforward.
Professor Murthy.
One more thing.
Yes.
This work which you are talking about, if you also mentioned briefly about generalizing this to standard model, right?
I couldn't find out
a
way to.
No, but I'm just curious to know, will that be related to the two-hoofed monopole?
Possibly, if one, but that's a graninified,
Polyakov-Hooft
model is a graninified.
No, that's because it is, you need a SU5 or something like that to get.
Yes, but I didn't have proper technical expertise to talk about graninified theory, but in the electroweak sector, I tried hard around that time to see whether I could extend the arguments in the electroweak sector, but I couldn't sort of get proper ideas.
There seems to be a comment in the original version of Satyen Bose's paper when he derives Planck distribution law.
Yes.
He writes 8 pi h nu instead of 4, and argues that the factor of 2 comes from the polarization of the photon and hence the spin. Apparently, that statement was removed by Einstein when he translated.
Yes.
So in which case, if there was communication between Satyen Bose and Saha, Saha would not question the spin of the photon.
I mean, Saha would have gone by Einstein's idea, and that's why he probably didn't.
But
what you say.
The factor of two was still there.
So Professor Murthy has highlighted a point which has appeared in Kameshwar Wali's article in Physics Today. So Kameshwar Wali, in the Physics Today article on Bose, he talks about a conversation with Partho Ghosh. Mm-hmm. And this story, Partho Ghosh reports that Bose, when he was fairly senior, had a chat with Partho Ghosh, and he pointed out to Partho that he had put that 8 factor to say that photons have 2 degrees of spin, but Einstein removed it. And possibly, if Saha knew about it, he would have placed more trust on Einstein, maybe that's the reason why in the Nature note, he disagrees with yes. the correct interpretation by Raman and Bhagavantam and says that photons don't have spin. Right. I don't know.
This is also there in Abraham Pai's book.
I see.
The
I see.
Statement.
I see. Oh, the statement. Yeah. I read it in Kameshwar Wali's yeah. article on Bose.
Bose talked about it here, right?
I see. I see. Yeah, so Saha, yeah, probably it changed with Einstein. So when Bose sent his English paper, which he could not publish it in Philosophical Magazine, and thereby he sent it to Einstein, there he writes that Bose. And thereafter, Einstein refers to Bose's work as Bose, and Rajesh Kochhar, who nowadays writes on historical aspects of Indian science, he sent to me a note saying that apparently Einstein was very cavalier about referring to S.N. Bose. He recommended his name for participating in a conference abroad, and he just said Bose, and the invitation went not to, no, to D.M. Bose. D.M. Bose himself was an established physicist. So probably the Basu to Bose transition happened during the Einstein-Bose interaction. Sorry? Basu. Right. Yeah, there itself is Bose. You're right, absolutely. Yeah, good. Very sharp of you to see that. So yeah, so possibly Bose himself wanted, because this is Bose's, Bose probably preferred that he be referred to as S.N. Bose, while Saha wanted, Saha was a bigger nationalist. Yeah, I mean, Saha, nowadays it's coming out that he actually actively sided with the rebels like Bagha, Yatin and because of which the British, secret agents had found out. And that's the reason why the FRS was delayed. He didn't receive it